You're listening to Magrito Podcast Network, celebrating the culture of Chicanos and Latinos one story and voice at a time. Listen to more Magrito Podcast Network shows over at magrito.net. Connect on social, on Instagram and Facebook at Magrito, the Magrito Podcast Network.
The Mind Buzz, now partnered with Magrito Industries.
I forgot for a second what I had to do.
The Mind Buzz is powered by Mind Buzz Media. Mind Buzz Media is an on-site video and audio podcast production company. Mind Buzz Media. Have you ever thought about starting your own video and audio podcast? Or do you have an existing podcast that you want to take to the next level? Mind Buzz Media brings a professional podcast studio to you. Visit mindbuzz.org for more.
This isn't the Mexican Kill Tony. What are you talking about?
It is the Mexican Kill Tony.
Shut up, Red Band. I mean, Jay. Yeah.
This is 100% Kill Bill.
Hey, fool, I didn't know you brought your fucking Chicano studies teacher today, dog.
You did. And hopefully you learned something.
Probably not. Not with the woman. I don't know.
I haven't walked through curtains like that since I was born. Never my mom. That was
Joy, hi, bang, me, mo, bong, pa, pa, ya, my, ma, bo, pai, ya, so, lo, lo, lo. Please feel free to sing along if you know the words.
You guys want to see Darby Cash next month again? Yeah? Yes or no?
I'll be honest, I would kiss you just for the bit.
Dude, you're not down.
You're not down. You're not down.
Oh, oh my God!
Oh, oh my God! Fucking comedy, open mic, damn it!
Friday, August 16th in the city of Paramount at Orchateria. It's going to be the Puro Laughs Comedy Night featuring Mikey McKernan, Johnny Gold, Sabrina Contreras, James Jablonski, Lala Kellums, and Danny Alvarez in the city of Paramount, hosted by the one and only Gil from the Mind Buzz. Oh, it's the podcast you're listening to. Come out and support. It's only $5 a ticket, and we got a special drink ticket that includes a discounted drink. You can find the link down in the show description. It's going to be a live recording. Come out in the city of Paramount. It's Friday, August 16th. It's going to be a party.
The Mind Buzz.
Angie and Johnny are on the podcast.
I double clicked.
What was that?
I double clicked it.
Oh my. Boom.
I'm a little rusty today.
Welcome back to the podcast. It's only been a week.
I know. But it's been a long week.
Welcome back to the podcast, ladies and gentlemen. This is the Mind Buzz Podcast with your host, Gil, and working the board today is Amber. How are you?
Today and every Tuesday.
Today, tomorrow, and forever. I am excited to get into today's guest. But first, let's talk about what we got going on in the Mind Buzz universe and Amber universe. let's see. Last week, recap on last week. Last week, we had Mikey Barajas on the podcast, and he's going to be hosting tomorrow's open mic. And if you're listening to this in the future, it was a great night. Let's see, what else do we got going on? August 16th, we have the comedy showcase in the city of Paramount with the ad that you just seen, James Jablonski, Johnny Gold, Danny Alvarez, Lala Kellums, Sabrina Contreras, and I'm hosting that one, so it's going to be fun.
And Mikey.
Mikey.
Or what's his name?
Mikey McKernan.
Yeah.
Of course, we can't forget about Mikey McKernan. He's also going to be on the podcast in the next couple of weeks, so I am super excited about that. And then we have the Boodle Laughs comedy open mic every Wednesday in the city of Paramount. Anything else? Do you have anything going on?
Nothing right now.
No speed dating, no markets, nothing like that?
Not yet.
No?
Not this week.
Not this week. I am excited
about this comedy showcase. We have one of the comics here in the studio tonight, and we're gonna get to talk to him like we did. He's been on the podcast for a few times on here. I'm excited. He's a listener of the podcast also, and he texts me every time we have an episode to give me his rave and rating on each guest. So I'm excited to talk to Johnny, and we have Angie too. Anything else before we talk to these?
And Angie, peeps? Angie's been on our show as well. Yeah. She's great.
All right. Well, I'm going to introduce him to you. Anything else?
I'm just advocating for Angie.
Of course. We have to.
Appreciate that, Amber.
I got you.
All right. Please welcome Johnny Gold and Angie to the podcast. Woo! There's Johnny. There's Angie.
That was horrible.
Thanks for being here.
It's just a horrible start. Well, how do you expect us to be entertaining on a podcast when you can't even introduce people right? I forgot Mikey McKernan's name.
Okay.
It's
right. Boo. It's Boo-ha.
He's great.
It's Boo-ha.
And listen, you have Angie, who is an up-and-coming, you know, something. We don't know yet. She just started doing comedy. She's fantastic. And
of course.
You just kind of left her out.
No.
I saw the tagline, too. I picked up on that clock that he said, here's Johnny Gold, amazing. He's on our show, and Angie's here, too. That's
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
See? Yeah, she's outside. See? On the sidewalk.
It wasn't just me.
We kept Angie outside because she's Asian.
No!
No, that's not right.
No, that's not.
Do you like Asian people, right?
Yeah, of course I do.
I don't like Asian comics. We talked about this before.
Wait, we did.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, Angie's the only one that I like.
Oh, yay!
Yay! I love it.
You did talk about that the first time you were
right.
on the show.
There's so many Asian comics I don't like. We could have an Asian hate podcast.
Oh, my God.
But we love Jesus. Them as human beings. But as stand-up comics, stay well. Listen, you have one of the most premier comics on your Horchateria. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
Wow.
I think so. Did he, Amber?
He did.
Okay.
He's learning.
I am. I like Mexicans. And I like El Salvadorians, and I like a lot of minorities. But I'll tell you, that the Asian comic that you have, she features, I forgot her name, she's on Kill Tony.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
We know who we're talking
Tran.
About.
Okay.
Nicole Tran. She's
ladies
hilarious.
And gentlemen.
Well, wait a minute. She's hilarious, Gil.
Of course.
If you could have an interpreter next to her, so then we could get the punchlines, I would like that.
All right. Well, I'll work on that.
But you know what? I got to teach her how to dress, too. Next time I see her, I'm going to maybe I'll bring some imitation, you know, dress wear that I can show her that's cheap. You can get online.
I think it's interesting that we got like 30 seconds in before you like dropped a name.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. He had it loaded in the cannon.
He
that's
did.
Why.
I'm really excited because I love Angie, and I think that...
Just let it all out now before we get started. Get it all out of your system. Anything else?
Well, yeah, your last guess was horrible. I mean,
Mikey's great. Mikey's a good guy.
The guy that was catatonic, I was worried about him. I'm not kidding. I almost called you and said, is he okay or is he in a trance?
You should have called me.
Oh, my goodness. It was like a horror movie. He would answer a question 10 minutes after you asked him the question. You're like, how long have you been doing comedy? He's like, it was like Mitch McConnell. He was like Mitch McConnell.
Mitch McConnell.
Yeah. Is he the Mitch McConnell of stand-up? He seems very young. And he likes jiu-jitsu, too. I thought it was interesting.
He was a good guy. Oh, well, Mikey's a great guy. Yeah. He's going to be out to our open mic tomorrow be hosting.
Right. We'll have the ambulance outside. Why is an ambulance out there? Well, this guy says. All right.
Got it.
Anyway, Gil, go ahead. It's
Johnny Gold, welcome to the podcast.
Yay!
I appreciate you. Thanks for coming.
Oh, didn't you want to play that song from the last 5 years?
Oh, no. You know what?
Which song was it?
I tried to learn on the ukulele. Did you know I was like, I'm so gravitated towards Johnny Gold for some reason. And it's about been like a year and a half since I've been on the scene. And this is like Biffle Bestie. This is my Biffle Bestie, Johnny Gold. And turns out
that's scary.
Yeah, it is.
It's a good thing.
Okay.
What? But It, I guess he's really into musicals. And that's something.
Musicals? Really, Johnny? Oh.
Look at his sleeve.
Didn't, my really? Body. Didn't you say your mom was.
Yeah, she was. She was right? On Broadway.
See, I listen.
Amber,
well, of course, you're the smarter one of us.
She is. She really is.
The Mexican wife is showing you up.
Thank you. I'll take it.
I mean, you're fantastic. You're organized. You can put sentences together. You probably graduated some sort of community college. You know,
I did.
You're together. I know if you did comedy, Gil, watch out.
Dust. I tell her all the time that I think she should. Great. I think so.
I also agree. I think Amber would be great.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Just try it.
I'm all right. I'm around too many of you guys. I don't know.
I like Angie because I think she's original, you know, and she doesn't do drugs or alcohol, which I'm totally against. And I think it's fantastic. You know, we have there's a lot of comics in the IE that are on the come up, you know, that are doing very well. She's one of them.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
I think Sandy, C's, Melissa.
Sandy and C's, those are my besties too.
Yeah, they're good. Josh, how do you say his last name? Hitler. Yeah, I love him. Owen Parker with the two names.
No, he's more Claremont. Yeah.
Darby Cash, who you said shouldn't charge for an open mic.
I don't think so.
Let's get it out, Gil.
I don't think
Darby's
so.
Darby's probably going to listen because he's, you know, retarded. I think he leaves his house. He goes, I know I'm special needs, but I'm going to make it. I'm going to make it.
You're crazy.
You're waiting for this. I love it.
I love podcasts because there's no audiences, and I hate audiences. They just get in the way of everything you fucking do.
It's like you do stand up, though.
I know, but when I look out there, so I did a show, and I looked out there, and I told them when I was up there, I said, I really don't need you people. It's just a waste of my time. I'm up here like judging me like I'm an animal in the zoo, you know? I hate that. Don't you hate it when they're looking at you, the audience?
They have to, Johnny.
Yeah.
They have to. They're there to see a show.
I know. But I mean, I can't have that, you know, I don't know. I like podcasts because you can just say and talk shit about people and then you don't get in trouble until you meet somebody on the street. I'll probably meet every Asian comic like at the liquor store.
Probably.
Have you ever pissed anyone off that like came up to you and like confronted you?
Because this is what, the third time you're on the show.
In general,
it's going to be a monthly thing. in general, no, I haven't had anybody.
Really?
No.
What do you think it is?
Because
it your white privilege?
Could be.
It's because he's Johnny Gold.
Yeah, I don't think there's any malicious intent toward it. I just don't think I do it. Like, when I came up, I was bullied. I had never been bullied before, and that pissed me off. And I thought, when I get better at this, I'm going to be more positive to people. So
then what happened?
No, I am. I think I am. I think when new comics, I try to be nice to new comics. I do sit in the back of the room and make fun of people. But, you know, what else am I going to do with a shitty
You know what? Right. You know what it is? I think we all do it. Every person does it.
And they're doing it in their head.
Exactly. Or they're doing it with their close friends.
Sure.
But you're out with it. You're open to it.
Well.
And there's no fear for that. And people don't like that.
But I think a lot of comics that are just starting out that are out here, I have a good relationship with them. The only thing I say, you know, some of these comics, like they're Angie's age, you start between 20 and 30, and that's kind of a time you want to have fun in your life.
Yeah.
So if somebody wants to drink and party, and I don't have a problem with it. I don't. I think when you turn 30, you got to put that shit away, and you got to be sober and do this. If you want to be good. If you just want to go to an open mic and have fun, I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah, I agree with
comics
that.
Comics are fun to be around.
What I like when I go on open mic, I love going to the back and sitting next to you because every time someone goes up, you're like, oh my God, this guy's fucking awful.
The commentary.
Yeah.
But I don't tell them that to their face. It's always good to talk behind people's back. Everybody knows. My mom taught me that. Uh-huh. Don't ever tell somebody to their face now. I've told people to their face. I have.
And what was the rebuttal to that?
Well, I told William Henderson once on a podcast, he had a pocket pussy joke.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the buddy system, I like them because they give a lot of comics stage time. They do a lot of work, Carlos, George, and Will. But that doesn't mean that if I'm on a podcast and I said you have a pocket pussy joke and I think it's horrible,
mm-hmm.
horrible. You're in a relationship with a fucking woman, man. Grow the fuck up. But he still does it. He just looked at me. He did look like he wanted to punch me because he's like a former jock from Michigan. But I'll just sue him and I'll win because I have a great lawyer in Century City. I'll be honest with you. The guy who started the buddy system, though, originally, I'm so glad he left. He was a bully, Nick Laney.
Really?
You know, it's funny. Nick Laney, I know all the secrets Nick Laney knows because he would talk shit.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. He was great at it.
I would have never thought that.
No. The guy who started the buddy system out here, I'm not even going to mention that faggot's name. I'm serious, man. He is a scumbag. He bullied Nick Laney. And he did a lot of bullying to a lot of people. It doesn't make the scene any better. If you're going to have a scene like the buddy system, for example, you should be nice to every new comic that comes up. If a new comic wants to talk to you, they talk to me all the time. I say, hey, you sign up over here. What are you being mean for? You want people. That's what you're doing. That's your job.
Yeah.
So when you have the horchateria.
Whether we like it or not, we have to be people. You know what I'm saying? Like there's customer service that has to go with it.
Right.
Whether you like it or not. That's how it is.
I hear comics, oh, he started talking to me, fist bumped me, did that. Well, dude, just get better at comedy. You don't need to worry about if somebody's coming up to you and fist bumping you. Just why don't you take care of your shit and be nice to people that come in? There's a lot of new comics that started it back to the grind. They're brand new. So now you're going to be an asshole and that's what they're going to be their first experience. But when you go to Chatterbox, they're like accepting. They'll make fun of you for being a new comic.
Mm-hmm.
They'll even make fun of you work at the Comedy Store. It's not a big deal. But they're supportive if you do good, right? Didn't Steve tell you that if you do another good set?
He did.
Yeah.
It was nice. That was all you, though. I feel like you were coaching me that entire time. I've been going to the Chatterbox.
I mean, I don't know why people are mean. I mean, some of these people have been doing comedy 2 or 3 years, and they should just keep their fucking mouth shut. But if they're coming up to me and we're talking, I'm not going to, like, Hollywood them. You know, I'm just going to talk to them. I don't think there's a new comic. Some of the comics that left the scene still reach out to me in other scenes, like back east or in Boston. They go, hey, man, you're always nice to me. Is it that much pain to be nice to somebody? You're taking money from comics and running an open mic. Mm-hmm. And so let's say there's 30 of them, and you're in a rush to get home, but you're supposed to be a leader of a scene. It doesn't make sense, man. Don't run open mics then.
Right.
Get somebody who really wants to do it, like you. You talk to everybody.
Yeah. I'm sorry to cut you off, Andrew, but I think that's just, you have to be like that. Like I think if you're just in it for money or to get some type of like, oh, prestige, like, oh, I'm doing this because of the, you have to like it. You have to like the people.
You have to like stand-up comedy.
And you have to like, yeah.
I think some of these people who run these mics hate stand-up comedy. They're always talking about quitting, and I don't know. Maybe they just want to get out of the house. Who the fuck knows?
Right.
I don't talk to those people about comedy. There's like 2 or 3 people ever since I started that I talked to about comedy. Yeah. The Leo is one of them because Leo can.
My 90s friend. Did you hear that?
Oh, is he a 90? How old is he?
I said that he's my 90s friend because I don't have his phone number. We don't have. Oh, I don't have his social media.
Like off the grid.
I don't even know where. I figured out he's from Fontana because of the hat he had in Riverside last week.
Yeah.
He's great. He's awesome.
You know, he's. He was probably in charge of the people that were supposed to protect Donald Trump. Like he works for like the CIA. I love him because when I'm not sure of a joke, I'll run it by him and he's always right. That's a gift. Mm. He goes to a lot of comedy shows. He goes, I'm seeing Colin Jost from Saturday Night Live and there's a guy opening for him and he's horrible and stuff like that.
I like the way he delivers comedy.
Yeah. Like in slow motion.
In slow, that's you know the riff I always do when I host great. And I go after Leo. I was like, I love Leo. It looks like he does comedy like he just got shot with a tranquilizer gun. Like I've never.
He well, when he did a show a mic in Claremont, he wrote 4 or 5 jokes about the colleges in Claremont. I just thought you went through every fucking college in Claremont. They have a lot of great colleges.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What were you going to say, Angie? I'm sorry.
I was going to say, or more like, because I know John and Gold saying all this stuff about like people who run open mics, but I wanted to hear his opinion on your open mic, because I know you run one. Do you think Gil runs a good one?
Oh, hell yeah. It's great.
You think so? Well, I appreciate that.
I like it. You know, the great thing when you're completely bored in the back, they have couches you can lay down. I have to. I don't know. Wow.
That's what I want to check out. It's just kind of far as hell.
It is far, but you're going to have to drive if you want to be a comic.
Oh, man.
You know, there's no rail system there. There is, but it's probably...
Rail system?
You know, like a
public
subway.
Transit.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, the closest one would drop you off, like in Lakewood.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How far do you have to drive to Paramount?
I guess it's about 45, 50 minutes.
Is it from you?
I don't know. Maybe not that
about
long.
Like 35,
yeah,
40?
Depends maybe. On the 91.
Right.
And it's a great mic, and the area is great.
And
you meet different comics from different scenes, a lot of L.A.
That's
comics,
the fun part.
And that's a great thing about Chatterbox.
I heard Steve went to yours.
Yeah, it was crazy.
That's so cool.
It was like the third month that we were running it.
And he put it down.
That's fine.
Oh.
We're... That's like seeing.
But that's how Steve is. It
right.
doesn't mean anything.
But I understand it because that's like seeing a new comic that's only 3 months in versus
sure.
seeing him again in 6 months.
Right.
Hopefully there's going to be some change, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think that it's early on. We're still trying to figure it out. Even after 6 months, we're still trying to make it best for everybody, make it best for the people that show up there, the Orchatria customers, the comics, and the producers. Like, there's more people involved, and I don't think people understand that don't run the mic. So if you're a comic going to an open mic, like, you just see what's going on.
Yeah,
like, there's behind-the-scenes stuff that are at play.
Sure, I get it.
That take months and months. For work. Friday, August 16th in the city of Paramount at Orchataria. It's going to be the Boodle Laughs Comedy Night featuring Mikey McKernan, Johnny Gold, Sabrina Contreras, James Jablonski, Lala Kellums, and Danny Alvarez in the city of Paramount, hosted by the one and only Gil from the Mind Buzz. Oh, it's the podcast you're listening to. Come out and support. It's only $5 a ticket, and we got a special drink ticket that includes a discounted drink. You can find the link down in the show description. It's going to be a live recording. Come out in the city of Paramount. It's Friday, August 16th. It's going to be a party.
Well, I think another thing is these open mics, the people who run it don't explain them very well to newer comics. Like, if you got up and said, okay, this is an open mic, if you've never done comedy before, you know, this is what we're about, and, you know, explain it.
We try to, I'm sorry, go ahead, Angie.
I was tangenting, this is a bit of a tangent, but I was going to say the reason we met is because the comedy club that I'm a part of at UCR, they host an open mic, and you just started showing up.
Yeah. Wow, that really put a lot into the podcast.
I was like, there's so much production value behind it.
Yeah, there's a lot of,
but
you did it at UCR at the college.
Yeah, but I was like, when we did the open mic, we just show up with a mic and a speaker, and who shows up.
So but still, it's a lot. You got the list. You got people coming in.
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
But what I'm saying is, if you get any type of mic scene and you explain it to people, sometimes people go to open mics. I didn't even know what an open mic was.
Wow. Mm.
No, who knew? I'd never been to one. I never walked into one. I did one. Nobody explained it. And if you just say, okay, you get 3 minutes, there's a light. Don't run the light. If you want to ask me any questions, I'll be in the corner. We also have comics here that have been doing it from anywhere from 1 year to 19 years. And then you can ask them questions, you know, to lay it out.
Right.
It would go a lot smoother rather than just sit in the corner and get high and fuck around.
Believe
That's
it
what
or,
most people
right.
do.
Believe it or not.
Not you, Gil.
No, I know.
You know the people I'm talking about.
Ricky and James are really good at that. Oh. I think they're really good at explaining like what our open mic is. Like at the beginning, James is always constantly telling me, hey, you forgot to say this. You forgot to tell him where the light is. You forgot to tell him you're going to get the light at 4 minutes, meaning they got 1 minute. I'm like, James, okay, you go tell him. You know what I mean? But I think they're really good.
And then when somebody runs the light, it's not their fault that they've been doing comedy 2 weeks. What do they know what the light is?
Right.
Even at the Comedy Store open mic, when they have it, they tell you the light's to the left, stage left.
On our sign-up sheet, we have, people don't read it, though.
No, they don't.
We have two lines explaining where the light is, what time, but nobody reads
but,
it.
Yeah. But I think I agree with Johnny when he says, having that, like, even if you have the same people every week, but who knows, maybe there's someone in the audience that, you know, potentially wants to do it and goes every time and they're nervous to do it because they don't know how to start. And I think that a lot of times when people do things and you already know a pattern, you know, people, there's already little, like, you know, groups formed. It's very intimidating for someone new to come in and want to be part of something that they don't even know where to start. Because that's kind of, I mean.
That's how I felt.
Yeah.
With the first time I went to the stand-up.
Yeah, exactly.
I went months before I even started stand-up.
Just to see how it worked.
Just to see how
everyone did it.
And I was terrified. I seen clicks everywhere inside the club. Yeah, and I was like, weird. I would never fit into that.
Sad.
Do you guys remember your first open mic?
I do. Mine was in San Pedro.
Where's that?
Because me, it's next to
South Bay, like Long Beach, right?
Yeah.
Oh.
And, the guy goes, "You could do 20 minutes."
I would kill myself.
But I no, but like I said, I've never been to an open mic. Mm-hmm. The guy looked like he was catatonic, like your guest last week.
Oh my God.
He just didn't say anything. Mm-hmm. And he just kept letting me go and go. And I was walking across the stage. It was a huge stage. And I was just like, you know, but this is before social media. So that the good thing is you had to learn everything by going to the place. Then they would explain it to you. So you had like on the in-job training. So you knew where the light was. You knew not to run the light.
Yeah.
Now everything, I think comedy now is probably the dumbest it's ever been based on social media. And I'll tell you why. Because now you can just watch videos. You really don't have to think. You know, a lot of people are quoting rappers and this and that.
But the same thing with podcasts, too. People are not watching full-length podcasts. No. They're just watching clips. Right. And people tell me, they're like, oh, I haven't really listened to your podcast, but your clips are great.
Yeah, that's the thing. When I say the people I see that I've been doing comedy with, I think there's the people I started with. One works for Chris Rock. One works for Joe Coy.
Really?
These people are fucking intelligent. Oh, now, when I perform with them, I always want to know what they think of my stand-up comedy. You know? So I get to have a really good perspective, because if I talked about some of this shit that they're talking about today, they would, you know how you talk about clicks when you walk in, they would disassociate themselves from me. I've seen it before. Mm-hmm. When I first started, I didn't know what I was doing, and I was sometimes by myself.
Okay, I take back all the nice things that I said about James Jablonski.
Why? What did he say?
This is a comment. It's live streaming.
Well, I can't read that.
It's James says, I watch all full-length podcasts, not just yours.
Look at all the nice
not
things.
Not yours.
All the nice things say. That I said about James.
I think James...
let it out.
No, I think... I've always... The reason I've always liked James is because we kind of have a connection through punk rock. He worked at shows, and I was a huge punk rocker for like 2 or 3 years. You know, the punk rock scene was small. It was only like 3 or 4 years. And I always liked him because I always thought that he was naturally talented. Like when I just think of myself when I started, I could not do anything with the new Angie or Sandy or C's or Melissa, all these people, they're way ahead of the game. Like I had stage fright.
Oh.
I was afraid to go on mics. My first 4 years, I must have got up about 10 times. Because I was just
first
hanging.
Four?
Yeah.
Really?
Well, first of all, I was in Hollywood, which was the biggest mistake of my life because there wasn't social media. So I just went when somebody called me up, there's a show in Hollywood, you want to try to get on? I didn't get on. I did open mics at the Hollywood Improv and stuff like that. It just, you can't get better. So I think nowadays with the so many open mics, you see people 1 to 4 years in, they're really good where they can do a lot more time. It's just a different time, that's all.
Yeah.
You know what I think is interesting? And I've thought about this. I was like, just because there is a bit of an age gap between us two, Mr. Gold.
A bit. It's like a lifetime.
Like 2 generations at least.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
2, that's it?
2.
Maybe 3.
But I was going to say, my generation of stand-up, at least for the people my age, they're so focused on getting like reels and clips.
Right.
And that's how they come up in stand-up. And so I'm wondering, I'm like, Johnny Gold, when are you going to post your clips?
Yeah. I only post pictures of me that make me look really good.
What? Yeah. What?
I'm like, Gil took a picture of me. Somebody took a picture. I go, well, I got to put that up. I have some videos that are really old.
I've seen them.
Yeah, and I agree with you on that. You know what really I hate about social media? The main thing is the masturbatory. The look at me. Look at, I'm on this. I'm doing this.
Yeah.
Hey, man. You know when they're talking in their phone?
Oh, I hate that shit.
Yeah,
if you're posting a story and you're talking directly into the camera, I think you should kill yourself.
I just think... Angie, that's the
I'm going to go to the rope. Yeah, I'm going to go to the rope store and the rickety thing store.
And you call me mean? You're talking about killing people.
That's fine.
That's, I mean, maybe it's a Gen Z thing. I think everyone throws kills.
No, I
that's that's weird coming from you because
really?
Because that's what you kind of grew up with, right? Hmm. Talking into the phone.
I guess it
just you don't like that or?
I guess it takes a certain level of perceived inflated self-importance for someone to post on their story and think people care about what I'm talking
about. How are you supposed to promote yourself if you can't do that?
I see. I might be thinking of like people who don't do like entertainment, I guess. Or maybe stand-ups with like 300 followers with maybe 20 story views.
That's a great point. You have to do it.
Right.
I'm not against it.
I think just at any level you have to do it.
Yeah.
If you how do you expect to grow or to get more followers or to build a following if you can't jump out of that comfortability?
I like to if the work I do on stage is good enough to get 1 or 2 fans, I would rather have that than somebody adding me on Instagram that I don't know, sells futures in Iceland. I don't know what these fucking people do. You know what I mean?
Sells
futures. You know, I got people on Instagram that I don't even fucking know. So, I mean, you know, if I post something like a video or if somebody wants to see a clip of me that I want to get a show on, then I'll do that.
Yeah.
I think, too, like, I get what Angie's saying because I think... I think she's Gen Z, so I think the whole like again like talking on the camera and things like that. Because my niece is Gen Z, and I think that generation is over it. Like it's a millennial thing, but I still like to go on social media and I do follow people. And even if it's nothing to do with me, there's some kind of sort of connection when you're. I don't know, laying there and just kind of doom scrolling and then someone's talking and then, you know, they're giving their perspective. Yeah, if I don't feel connected, then I'm going to scroll away. But if I do, it's, I don't know, there's something about it. And maybe it is my generation and down that kind of connect with that. But mm-hmm. I see your point, and I also see like what Gil and John, you're saying is just like, you know, you kind of have to put yourself out there. And I don't know, people feel connected sometimes when.
Can we just go back to saying how horrible that last guest was? I think that will get more views.
Johnny, no, I get what you're saying. I get, okay, if to build fans, come out to my shows, right? But I think the landscape has changed because of social media. And you have to, you can't. 100%. Push that away. You right. have to jump yeah. on what's going on.
I'm not against it.
Right.
I like to focus on the quality of the work I do on stage.
Of correct. So I think that plus the other thing, which is clips.
Of course, that's what Nick Lane
having
said,
a presence yeah. on social media. 100%. Those two things together.
I agree. I'm not against it. I love yeah. what you and Darby do. I love the videos and
Love the videos Darby does. Yeah, they're so fun.
I think it's great. I'm not against it. I love movies. I love right. the whole thing. I just, you know.
But it's not stand up. I get that part yeah. too.
Also, just really quickly, I love this comment that says, referring to you, Johnny Gold, that says his clips are still on the wind up camera.
Was that your last guest finally making a smart comment?
That was Ricky.
Ricky, oh yeah, wind-up camera. You know, those are coming back, actually. I saw somebody with a wind-up camera, yeah. Fuck you. Oh.
Is the wind-up camera like in Rent, you know, when he has this thing?
Yeah.
Is that what
yeah.
this is?
I don't know. Why do they, what is that when they're winding? Is that keeping the battery going or
they're
something?
They're cranking something. Ooh. I'm not too sure. Maybe Amber can pull up what that crank is for.
Sure. Yeah, or maybe that's just for the visual for the movie Rent, too.
Yeah.
But I think that's how you did do... shoot movies. It's not like with the iPhone or whatever.
This isn't the Mexican Kill Tony. What are
it
you
is.
Talking about?
It is the Mexican Kill Tony.
Shut
panel.
Up, Red Band. I mean, Jay.
This is 100% Kill Gil.
Hey, fool, I didn't know you brought your fucking Chicano studies teacher today, Doug.
You did.
And
hopefully you learned something.
Probably not. Not with the ones. I don't know.
I haven't walked through curtains like that since I was born. My mom. That was
Trời ơi bạn đi một tuần có không gặp mày mà bốn mày dân tù lù tù lù. Please feel free to sing along if you know the words.
You guys want to see Darby Cash next month again? Yeah? Yes or no?
I'll be honest, I would kiss you just for the bit.
Dude, you're not down.
You're not down. You're not down.
Oh, oh my god! Only
a comedy open mic, damn it! Oh my. Welcome to my kingdom. Or it could be the film, like moving the film throughout.
Oh, yeah, the reel. That's what I'm thinking.
Right, that makes sense.
The real reel. Right.
This is just a silly tangent question, but I was like, you're a millennial.
Mm-hmm.
What are you then?
I'm Gen X.
You're Gen X.
Yeah, because he's not old enough to be a boomer.
Boomer?
Yeah, I'm on the cusp, actually.
Really?
Ooh. Yeah. I've been trying to guess your age the entire time. I don't think you've ever said it out loud.
I'm
you
in
don't
my
have
late
to.
50s, and just keep it at that.
Okay.
You know what I...
Hey, man, the smoothie guy today said I look 48. And I was
wow.
like, and you know, what, like, I, thank you know you. What I said to him? I go, I want to marry you. He goes, wait a minute, I'm just making you a smoothie. I go, no, we're married.
I'm not trying to scare anybody here, but we've seen a statistic, I think it was last week they were saying, about just kind of like the presidential, how everything's going, right?
Right.
And they were saying like from the first time that people voted for Trump were a lot of boomers. And they were saying that since then to now, it's like I don't know, I want to say like 200,000 boomers have like, and that's probably low, have passed away. Ugh. Like hundreds and thousands of them that voted that time for Trump. And then they were saying now it's your generation that emerged.
I like how you put the
that,
camera on.
I know, and I went and I...
That you, it moved from Johnny... To Angie, okay.
Amber, this is bad news for me.
Okay? I know. I said I don't want to scare anybody, but
well,
I was
get
just
the
thinking
good
about
news
that
for Johnny. Okay, Amber,
you're
on
good.
My
you're
side.
Good. You're good. You're not, but you're not a boomer yet.
You're so good.
You're fine.
You eat really well. You go to the gym. You're a vegetarian.
But I could get hit by a bus. Is that what you're saying?
You go to open mics. Yeah, you hang out with comedians. You're great.
You don't have stress of anybody. You're good. You only have your own stress.
No, I'm not retired.
You still work?
Yeah, you can't be retired in California.
Oh.
I own a house.
Why did I have the idea that you're retired?
I wish I could be.
Oh.
You think I like working? I hate it, man. I know. I'm at kind of like the end of my wits for working. Working is just so much of a... I've been working since I was like 7.
Oh, 7? That's a single-digit number.
I delivered newspapers, man.
Like on your bike and you were like throwing it out?
No,
like
I walked. I was in San Francisco.
You were walking really far uphill.
One time I got so confused, I dumped every San Francisco Chronicle in the gutter. It was like... 50 of them. Nobody got their paper. But guess what? I went home and had cereal.
Dang. So you had to walk up those streets uphill?
I loved it.
Your calves must have been crazy.
I love San Francisco's is to me, of all the cities I've lived in, I lived in a lot of big cities. That is my favorite. I love San Francisco. I don't know what it's like today. When I lived in it, it was community. Hmm. Everybody was like, it was. Very highly educational, a lot of scholars, even though we lived in the ghetto. They were like co-ops, but they were all teachers and workers and, you know, like people that belonged to unions and they had families. You can go to walk around and go to all the families for Thanksgiving. I was poor is during Halloween when my mom gave me a pillowcase to put my candy in. That is
that means you're
shit.
Poor?
That's some ghetto shit, man. And then they snatch your purse, the pillowcase.
What were you, like, what did you dress up for Halloween on that year?
I like Spider-Man.
It was Spider-Man?
Yeah. Sometimes I just go like by my, like,
you're
just
that
like.
Poor. If you had a Spider-Man outfit. The plastic ones?
Oh, those are
cool. Those are cool. Yeah, I like those. I remember those.
Are you going to start collecting them?
I should.
We have one.
We do have it.
Oh,
actually,
really?
We do have
it. I was say, I think it would have said something interesting that you bring up your job because I swear to God, I thought you were retired. If I remember correctly, you were a truck.
Yeah, I own a diesel truck shop.
Wow.
Oh, is that what you do?
Yes, I do.
I never knew what you did.
Right now, I'm having a problem with an Asian client, and I think that has a lot to do with the Asian comics.
Your Asian hate?
Boy.
That's where it started.
He's going to start Asian hate. That's what it's
That's called. Weird. I don't know why. I don't know why. I have a gong in my house.
You do?
Yeah, my brother sent me a gong.
That's awesome.
I know. It's great.
But I guess the reason I bring this up is because, Gil, I just graduated college. I don't have a job yet. Mm-hmm. But I was like, when I talk to you guys at open mics, you guys have just the smorgasbord of the randomest day jobs I've ever heard of in my life. And I think it's so silly.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah, some people have weird jobs.
Yeah, like C's works for water bottles and Sandy's a plumber and
Sandy's a plumber? Oh, he looks like
a
plumber.
No, he takes you're getting it all wrong.
Oh, I am?
Typical Asian. Sandy is like a manager of several apartment complexes.
Oh.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm sorry, Sandy, for calling you.
Yeah. Well, Sandy's never going to forgive you. And C's, I think you got it right. He does work for a water company. He does something. I don't know. I know it's in sales or marketing.
Gil, what's yours?
I don't even know what I do at this point. Like, what do I do?
Have a podcast.
He's a stay-at-home boyfriend.
Yeah.
Wow.
A professional stay-at-home
boyfriend. You mean you're a pimp. I dig it, man. That's some cool ass
No,
shit.
He's the hoe. I'm the pimp.
I could see that.
Pretty much.
No, Angie. We work for our family and for ourselves.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We make videos. What else do? We make videos. We have a podcast.
We create websites. We do social media.
So it's like marketing, kind of marketing.
Ooh,
marketing, social media.
Great. For Horchateria.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and other small business too. We have clients.
Can I go over the menu at Horchateria with the owner to try to put some really good vegetarian dishes on there?
Past 8 o'clock.
Yeah, don't you get people in there past? What is wrong with California? Especially Los Angeles. They just close like that. Like at 8, I did a...
That's weird because you're on this side of town, right? Versus right. LA. I feel like over here in the Inland Empire closes a lot earlier than LA.
Yes, I agree.
You know, there's just nothing to eat late night after you get out of a mic. We did
Taco Bell.
I don't eat that shit.
McDonald's.
But I was forced to go to this place called Raising Cane's.
Oh, yeah. This place called Raising Cane's?
You don't like it?
That's a cultural icon.
The chicken strip place?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, first of all, it was in Hemet. And Justin Fox.
Well, there's your first.
No, shout out to Justin Fox. I love Justin Fox. He runs a great show.
We're not
show.
Talking about Justin. We're talking about Hemet.
But I go, Justin, is there anything open besides In-N-Out?
Uh-huh.
He goes, yeah, we got a new Raising Cane's. And I went there at like 2:30 in the morning. We're up there eating. I had French fries and coleslaw. That's all I could get.
Yes.
I know.
My kiss.
But I mean, in general, don't you think that restaurants close earlier in all of, you know, Southern California? I don't know about
it. I really can't have an opinion because I've always lived here.
In-N-Out. I can't go to In-N-Out because of Nick Laney.
My side of town.
You were there the other week.
No, I was not.
A couple weeks ago.
I would hang out.
Oh, wait. Did you go? No, you didn't go. Never mind. I take that back.
I get sad when I go there.
I said that last week, too, that you were there 2 weeks ago. I take that back because you're right. You weren't there.
You know what? I wanted to bring up a couple things that I hear a lot of comics talk about. First of all, let's talk about comics that start out as young as Angie.
There's none of them, Johnny Gold. There's no one.
You know what? I was just thinking about that like 2 days ago, right, Amber? I was like, man, I wish I would have started this like when I was 25.
It's so hard because they don't have a lot of life experience. If you talk about Angie, I don't know. There's some new comics, you know, even Owen Parker and,
Darby.
Josh, what's his last
Josh
name?
Is the only guy on Darby's the scene that's younger than me.
Darby's in his 20s?
Yes.
Josh 25. Is great, actually. Yeah. He's going to be a great comic in the next 10 years.
And there's a good thing. Look, he's in his early 20s. He doesn't drink. He takes care of himself. And when he gets up there, and let's face it, he just started doing comedy.
Yeah.
His jokes, some of them are very good. And the way he, you can see the difference between a guy that is completely sober, a guy, he's good looking, he's got a great body, he's got good abs too.
How do you know Jesus. This?
I touched him. Oh. I don't know why, I just bumped into him. God, you got
stomach.
Are you
just randomly touching abs out here, Johnny? What are you
why
doing?
Why not? Right. Listen, he is so good. Even his bad jokes work. Mm-hmm. Because he's so confident the way he tells them, because he's completely sober and he's going to work through everything. And by the time he's 30, listen, he could bomb for the next 7 years and experiment. Mm-hmm. It's going to be so great because by the time he's 30, he's going to blossom like a beautiful cherry tree.
Oh, I'm going to tell Josh you called him a beautiful cherry tree.
Yeah.
He's going to hear this.
Is he going to hear this?
Why do you think that there aren't that many young comics?
That's a brilliant question.
Well, it's like you said, it's intimidating for one thing. It's a very intimidating thing, stand-up comedy, because of us. We'll see a new comic, and then, you know, it's just hard to be 22. I mean, I remember when I was 22, I was drooling on myself.
Oh.
I could never do open mics. I was working in a movie theater.
Johnny Gold, sorry. I think about this so often. I pray that there's people more my age that go to open mics. Yeah, and I wonder why.
Well, there's a lot. I mean,
I want friends my age.
I mean, you can have a friend that's in between 20 and 30. That's fine.
You guys are like older 20s or older. Older.
Thank you.
She's like, you guys are old fuck.
I was like, you guys are geriatric.
You know, wow.
You know who your friends are, huh?
Yeah, you think, you know, you really spend time with these people, and all I'll say it's because she's Asian. I think that's it. And another thing I wanted to bring up, you know, I really look up to you, yourself, and Sandy. I know it's very hard to do this at that age, man. And
Sandy's like 30.
No, he's 28, but he started when he was like 25. It's just this, it's just, you know, you remember when you were that age.
Yeah.
If you really think about all the great artists that took it seriously, it's not, it's harder to be young now because there's nothing really happening in the world that is a revolutionary. But if you take Bob Dylan, he wrote some of the best music in the history of time when he was in his, when he was Angie's age. Because there was the Vietnam War, there was the civil rights movement, the women's movement. It's just a different time. If you ever watch a documentary on Bob Dylan or Joan Baez, they're in their early 20s, but they sound like they're 45.
Can you look up how old Bob Dylan was when he wrote Blowing in the Wind?
Sure.
I want to say that.
Do you ever just say please when you...
Please.
No.
Amber, please, Amber.
I got you. I got the Thank Mexican you. Wives back. No problem.
Who is Bob Dylan?
What?
You're about to find out, right?
See,
now.
That's the problem. There is nobody talking about anything of any depth today on stage. It's because we're in such a nothing society right now. There's nothing going on. When you listen to artists, and artists should be ahead of the game, who is talking about anything besides jerking off or that? Come on, Gil.
Yeah.
It's just.
But you're
You're right.
But it's, I don't blame them. I don't blame
or
them.
Or F this and F that.
I don't blame them. Yeah. I'll be honest with you. They're a product of their environment. Like Nina Simone said, talk about the world around you when you're on stage. I believe that. But I grew up in a time where it was the tail end of all that shit.
Bob Dylan was still an inspiring folk singer, age 20, when he wrote Blowing in the Wind.
That's because the time.
Like, 20 years
what's
old.
What's happening now that's really changing?
That's him, Angie.
Can you please pull up a video so Angie can hear Blown in the Wind? It's
folk music.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah, you love music. You'd love this.
You'd love Bob Dylan, I think.
He had an interesting voice, but this Blowing in the Wind is like one of his worst songs.
There's so?
Oh, God.
Really?
Have you ever heard like... there's so many things.
The Mind Buzz is powered by Mind Buzz Media. Mind Buzz Media is an on-site video and audio podcast production company. Have you ever thought about starting your own video and audio podcast? Or do you have an existing podcast that you want to take to the next level? Mind Buzz Media brings a professional podcast studio to you. Visit mindbuzz.org. For more.
Blown in the Wind is one of the most influential protest songs of all time. But what does the man who wrote it think it's all about? In April 1962, Bob Dylan Greenwich Village music venue.
He really didn't. He said none of his songs were about protesting the war and civil rights, but they all were. But he said, I don't write like that.
Oh.
See if you can find where he sang it.
I'm going to give you what I could find.
No, he plays it in live in New York for like the very first time.
Oh, you okay. Boy, you're really going deep dive.
I know.
That's okay.
New York.
It's too hot back here.
It is. Why isn't the air conditioning on?
Because of the sound, I'm assuming?
Yeah.
New York.
Right there, just enter.
I know how to type something.
That's fine. March 1963 is fine.
But Gil, I'm glad it's okay with you.
How many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man?
Never heard this.
Yes, and how many seas must a white dove sail before she sleeps in the sand? Yes, and how many times must the cannonballs fly before they fall?
Has he written a song that I would know? Or would this be the one that I would know?
Some, my friend, is a blowing in the wind.
Like a Rolling Stone, maybe?
Yeah, play that one. That's fantastic.
Or do you know Adele?
Adele, like the singer?
Yeah, the Adele singer.
Yeah.
She does a cover of one of his songs.
Oh. She does?
Yeah.
Which one?
She does, what is it called? Ah!
This is why we do the podcast, so people can learn who Bob Dylan is.
The Rolling Stone, is that the name of the song?
Like That's a Rolling Stone.
Like a Rolling Stone. That is great. That's like one of
You think favorites. That one's better than Blowing in the Wind?
Well, it's just different. Mm.
Oh, there it goes. It's called Make You Feel My Love.
Wait, that's...
it's a cover.
Adele didn't write that one?
No.
That's one of my favorite songs.
Bob Dylan wrote about 50 great songs.
Yeah.
A lot of people didn't like his voice, but you have to remember it's folk music. There was just a good...
When the rain is blowing
I do know this song. Amber, you're a genius.
It's one of my favorite songs, but I knew she didn't.
Oh, wow, I didn't know Bob Dylan did this.
Yeah. So yeah, it's not an Adele song.
Yeah. Oh. Well, now I know. Thank you, Amber.
There you go.
I mean, with all the social media or the internet, you should probably know all the older.
But do you think we're kind of like, okay, like when rock and roll came out or these songs came out to the generations before us, they were like, oh, these songs have no substance. It's just noise. Do you think we're in that era of where we think like the newer generation's music has no substance and no anything? Like, is it just repeating itself? Like, or do you really think that there's just nothing in there? Because I feel like music... Within the times you kind of, or the music you gravitate towards is music that you can find a common ground or something that kind of touches you or makes you think or makes you have some kind of emotion, right? So you, Johnny Gold, there isn't something that, I don't know, what's her name, Taylor Swift is singing about that you can relate to. So you don't feel like there's substance in it for you, but maybe Angie, I don't know if you like Taylor Swift, but...
No, but I love Olivia Rodrigo.
Okay, well, there you go. Like, I wonder if that's the thing or music just... Because I feel like that. I feel like music now has no... There's no substance towards it. Sorry. Aww. But I really don't. But I don't feel like... there's anything for me to relate to.
Yeah, you make a good point because there isn't really anything. I mean, I saw Lady Gaga in concert with my girl back in the day.
Mm.
There was the best thing. I had a great time. When I was with my girl, I go, I think this is a present for you. It's my birthday. I enjoyed it. There was a guy completely naked next to me that was just dressed in yellow police tape. And I thought it was so awesome. I go, dude, I don't know how you pulled that off. It was great.
Did you touch his abs too?
No.
That's a good callback, Gil.
That is a good callback.
Yeah.
God, no. I was trying to act like I was straight. Even though I was at a Lady Gaga concert. By the way, she swears a ton.
Lady Gaga?
Oh, yeah.
Have you heard
fucking
the...
monsters. Yeah.
Have you heard the conspiracy about her?
Oh.
No, pull up the. I'm sorry. Are we gonna go into a different tangent or?
No, I just thought. I thought she was. I think she has a lot of really good songs. I like Lady Gaga. Mm. I'm not a big fan of Drake or Kendrick Lamar just because I don't really know them.
Mm.
You know, if I don't know them, how I'm not gonna say I hate them because they're Drake and Kendrick Lamar. I just know that one song that they keep playing.
The
one where he says they're not from here.
They're not like us.
Yeah, they're not like us.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, I'm white, so I don't give a fuck. Come on. Who cares?
This is just a really quick tangent on the subject of Lady Gaga and also Gen Z. I'll vouch for them, but I was like, we have our own up and coming Lady Gaga. At least I think so. But Chapel Rowan, do you know the name?
Mm-mm.
Oh,
mm-mm.
Fuck. Okay, well.
Put us on to what's her name?
Who? Chapel Rowan?
Chapel Rowan.
Yeah.
That's a badass name. Too.
It sounds cool.
Yeah.
She's the coolest. She has the
Chapel.
Same, yeah. The same stage presence as Lady Gaga. She's
really?
A really big like queer for like queer icon. Yeah.
So anyways, back to Okay, so
oh yeah.
Chapel
Yeah,
Rowan.
There it is.
Oh. Chapel Rowan, Lady Gaga.
Oh, I see there's a lot of comparisons to Lady Gaga.
Mm.
Yeah, but she's more like my
That's interesting.
Age. Yeah, you haven't seen her?
So she has the same, like...
That's her?
Yeah. Oh,
bigger wow. than life presence, mm-hmm. Crazy outfits, mm-hmm. makeup. Okay.
I don't think that's a crazy outfit. She's a performer. How's that crazy?
Crazy than normal people,
crazy than,
Johnny.
Like, Taylor Swift or, like, Ariana Grande.
I've seen people dress like that.
No. Crazier?
Nah, that's not crazy. There's no crazy. No,
there's no crazier than eccentric. A police tape abs man at Lady Gaga concert.
Have you seen the way Leo dresses? Dresses like he just got done roofing somewhere.
You know who has a cool sense of style?
Roofing.
He's eccentric. I like Sandy's wardrobe a lot.
Yeah, it's
I think
cool.
Me and Sandy dress semi-similar.
It fits him. And also Molina. I always forget.
Ricky Molina.
I call him Rafael Molina. I don't know why, because I think there's another comic. But there Ricky is. Molina, I love his style.
He's great. Yeah.
Isn't it?
He dresses great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's a sweetheart, too.
I think the style is, I'm not going to say crazy right now, but I think it's crazy that, I like it. I think it's crazy that so many things, fashion is just like, it gets recycled. Like so many things that you guys are wearing now are things that we wore in high school. And
really?
Like to see like the baggy jeans, like the band tees, the like, like things like my niece wears. I'm like, I had that. Like we had that. Like, and it's crazy that it's being recycled, but also in a different way.
Yeah,
the platform shoes, the bell bottoms.
I'm bringing the white pants back.
You're bringing the white pants back.
I evidently KJ copied my style.
KJ,
but I give him slack because you know he's poor.
KJ keeps the tag on his white pants, which is a KJ.
That's like a move that a lot of people do. That
why do you keep the tag? Why?
So you can return it.
I feel like that's the only reason why.
Yeah, but she...
Does he still have like the security monitor on them too?
No, but there was a while where people would leave the big tags on the pants.
Yeah, it's just beeping everywhere you go. Or just in and out of every store.
You know what's kind of funny? Because my mom, and I was just talking to Amber about this. My mom used to buy things from like people on the streets. Just weird at a discounted price.
Sure.
Like bikes and like different toys and stuff. Yeah, the bikes were probably stolen. Now that I realize
it. Where do you buy them at?
Just from people.
That's nefarious.
We'll talk about that later. But right. No, I remember she got me these pants, and the pants still had that security thing.
The plastic clip.
Yeah, and we didn't know how to take it off. So
you can ruin a pair of
pants. Yeah, I ended up not wearing them because
you
gotta
go to the place, and they have this stamp thing that takes them out. Because
I
bought a very
does
expensive,
it really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's cool.
I bought an very expensive pants, and they left it on. And I had to go back.
Yeah.
And if you try to take it off, you'll just rip your pants.
Whoa.
And it does stain them.
Yeah, some of them release ink.
That's cool. Ooh.
So that you don't steal stuff. So if you were to steal it and you break it open, your pants are ruined.
You know, I've been hearing a lot, to change the subject, I've been hearing a lot of comics on podcasts, you know, say that. Let's make it entertaining for the idiots that are listening
to this.
Because we want to, what's that fat kid's name that helps you out down there? The one that said I'd do a wind-up camera. What's that fat motherfucker's name?
He's beefy.
Yeah, he's beefy.
Thicky.
Oh, Thick Rick, huh?
Is that his name?
No.
Thicky, his name is Ricky.
Thicky Ricardo on Instagram, Adam.
But it's not on his driver's license because he doesn't have a car. Anyway, listen. The reason I wanted to bring this up is because I hear a lot of comics. I heard this on the I heard this on the Buddy Cast, actually. Where you're kind of selling your jokes because of, I don't know why. Like, if let's say you're gay or this or that, mm-hmm. you want to sell it to the audience. Like, drop it in their lap and go, look at me. I'm telling you something where I'm not going to offend you or not say something. I think that happens a lot in comedy where people believe in woke and cancel culture. I don't think there is any of that. Any of that. Unless you do something illegal. But if you do something illegal and you work for Staples, you get arrested. So, but I just don't want comics. I hear these comics. I don't say I have a job, so I look professional. I'm gay, but I don't want to talk about it. I want to gingerly set it in their lap. That's called a used car salesman. So when you're working and doing material, just talk about your life like it's a movie and stop fucking being a fucking bitch. It's just so
stop being a bitch.
Yeah, it's just ridiculous the shit that these
are you drunk with. Johnny, he called me bitch outside. Well, he texted me, he was like, I'm here, bitch. And I walked outside, I was like, Johnny, what's up with this bitch talk? Are you drunk or something? Like, what's the matter with you? You never talk to me like this.
You know, I
just, love you, Johnny.
I love you too. I want people in our scene to be better.
Yeah,
that's all I care about. I really do. I like to have fun at open mics. I mean,
I like to have fun at open mics.
Yeah, it's fun. But when you're on stage, let's break down all this bullshit and get rid of all this fucking shit that's ego driven. Mm. And just, who cares if you're gay? Who cares if you're a fucking horse? I don't give a fuck what you are.
Or a gay horse.
Right. Tell your fucking story and tell it warts. I mean, all the insecurity and the emotion and all that out, and you'll be original, which is more important than anything is being original.
Absolutely.
You can't be original if you're an alcoholic or a drug addict because you have no emotion. There's no emotion in when you're talking.
Mm.
Like when you sing that song about sleeping with your cousin.
Oh, spoiler alert.
Well, I mean,
spoiler.
What do you mean spoiler alert?
That's the punchline.
Yeah, all right, Angie. You're going to write 1,000 songs. Yeah. Whatever. You're not gingerly telling him that's the crutch, that's the whole thing of your, you know, you're just singing and you're just all this shit that people worry about. But she's sober, so she says it, and it really comes out through her emotion. People that are high and drunk on stage have no emotion. They waste our time. Matter of fact, forget about people that are just starting to do comedy. Kick out the motherfuckers who are drunk and stoned because they're wasting my fucking time. I couldn't even get up at an open mic the other day. Because I don't even know how, but certain other motherfuckers got up.
Mm-hmm.
I was a little kind of miffed about that.
Also, Johnny, you've been around the scene. Why are there so many like dick jokes? Like, do you try?
Because it's easy, I think. Yeah, I think.
That's what I'm talking about, because they think people are going to like. Comics write shit out of fear. Once you get over that and write your story, like all the deep shit that you have in your bowels that you're afraid to talk about is all the stuff that you'll eventually talk about. Mm-hmm. Like when I started doing comedy and I look back till now, this is exactly the comic that I thought I would become. Hoping. But I bombed so many times, you know, I got frustrated. But I never changed. And the comic I am today is through bombing and trying and keep going and trying to level up every year. Mm-hmm. Like every 2 years, you should. If somebody hasn't seen you in 2 years and they've seen you go, God, you're getting good, that means you've worked at it. But if you're the same after 10 fucking years, you wasted 10 years of your fucking life. Yeah. But this is for people to take it seriously. If you just want to go out and have fun at an open mic, I think it's great.
I want to say this. I'll say this to Gil, because I met you for the very first time in like the beginning of the year. And then I just saw you again maybe last week. And your writing has gotten a lot better.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Yeah. I think, you know what it is? I've gotten, like what you just said, I've gotten more personal and talk about it. Talk about my dad, my family, my mom. But see, it's hard. Honestly, it's
very hard.
Very difficult.
I didn't do that. When I first started, I was just talking observation comedy because I didn't think, nobody thinks their life is, when you really think about your life, you know, you think all the boring shit, there's stuff, but it's the stuff that you're afraid to talk about.
Absolutely.
That will eventually put you over the top to be original. I'm not talking about famous. I'm talking about you'll stand out. That's what you want to do. You know how many comics are in LA? There's got to be 7,000 or 5,000. So if you start separating yourself from people that maybe you're not as funny as people, but you're separating yourself through originality, you're going to get noticed and you'll get a lot of bookings.
I used to, like, Gil and I always have conversations, and obviously I don't do stand up and I'm not a comedian, but I would always tell him, like, I think when, like, Angie, what you said, like, dick jokes, like, I think it's easy for people to make those things up because they know that in some scene it'll work and people laugh at dick jokes, fart jokes, whatever, you know, those type. But I would always tell Gil, like, when I like when he writes, like, jokes of like his personal life, of his parents, of his, because no one can tell you that your joke is wrong or that what you're saying is not true, because that's your life. That's what you really went through, versus just making up a joke that you think are gonna, it's gonna make people laugh. Like, you know, and you, do you kind of know what I'm trying to say? Like, so I agree with Johnny, like using your life as like part of your kind of your ammo. It's, I think, yeah. I like when comics do that.
I think it's great, but it is scary. I'll be honest with you, when you're first starting out, I mean,
oh yeah,
to talk about, you know, James Shablonsky talks about having stepkids, and there's certain people that talk about that, but it is hard for a person that's young like that to do that. It's very hard.
I was going to say, I think I read this somewhere, and I feel like it holds such a candle to like why I, what I really try to do with my joke writing, where it's like the best kind of jokes for a comedian to tell are ones that only that comedian can tell. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So that's, it's like, if someone went up and tried to do my fucking cancer song, it's not going to work.
It won't work because it's not their story.
Carlos Medrano has a cancer song.
There it is.
Is there someone else with
there
a
it is,
song?
Ladies and gentlemen. I was waiting for it.
That's our thing, man. We always
No, it's not. Why did I high-five you? I didn't want
you
to.
You did it.
I didn't want to. Carlos, I love you. You know, I come back to the podcast.
Yeah, no.
Oh, was that the guy that Johnny Gold's been ripping on for the past hour?
No,
no.
Which
life.
One?
What are you talking
There's
about?
A lot.
Oh. This is the first time he talked about him.
Oh, I see.
On the pod, on this podcast. However, if
for
you
the
watch
last
the
hour, I haven't mentioned his name.
No.
Oh, I'm mixing him up with the guy who was on Gil's podcast last week.
It took,
I don't
you,
even
it
know
took
that
you
guy's
long
name.
Enough.
I'm gonna be honest with you, the guy that was on Gil's podcast last week could be from Mars. I'm not kidding. This guy, he was cracking me up. I'm like, okay, should I go down to Gil's house?
Make sure they're okay.
Bring in the thing when that horrible thing happened to the Daryl Hamlin. He's the guy who died on the football field. Remember, they brought him back to life.
Oh,
wow.
Yeah, it was during the playoff game. God, it was great. I felt like we needed one of those machines. But you know, he'll be at the open mic tomorrow. I'll tell him. Hey,
let
listen,
him know.
Bring
I
the defibrillator.
Try going to yours, Gil. Listen, it seems fun.
Yeah. Try it out. It's fun. It's really fun. It's a good place to have an event. It's awesome. I love it.
It'll take you like an hour if you go through the street, Angie.
Oh, meow. That's
oh,
because so
you don't do freeways, huh?
Oh, I do, but I feel like I would catch traffic. I'm right by the 91.
You don't do
going
don't
that
go
way,
freeways?
No.
I try not to.
I don't blame you. I don't. Yeah. Kid, driving at your age is, you know, I mean,
you got to do it once, though, Angie.
Yeah. I want, the one I'll come out for is Gil Tony.
You've never been there at all?
No, the one time I wanted to go on that one because he had an amazing panel.
Why don't
was
you
fucking
have your dad drive you?
Oh, he would not. He doesn't want to.
Well, I mean, I met her dad. And
Gil, did I tell you I made my dad be Johnny Gold?
That was weird.
How weird was it?
I've met a lot of dads when I've been in relationships. The funniest thing is every dad I've ever met in all the relationships I've been in, I've been nervous. And then I meet the dad and I go, God, this guy's an idiot. He's just a fucking, except there was one I don't want to mention, but it was beautiful. But I met Angie's dad.
Yay.
He was worried.
The reason
he was worried.
The reason I wanted my dad to meet Johnny Gold is because I'm younger,
oh,
and
okay.
Someone could scoop me off the street right after an open mic so fast.
Why would somebody scoop you up?
There's a lot of weirdos out there.
No,
Johnny.
I know, but you gotta, you know, get with Carissa Gomez. She has all the artillery.
She does.
She does.
And if she'll show you if
you
she
know,
doesn't tell you.
Cool. In James Bond, one of the bad guys had a boot. But in the front of the boot, a little knife stuck out.
Oh.
Yeah.
I should put that on my Docs, my Doc Martens.
Yeah, and you just like hit a button and then a little knife comes out and you kick them. I don't blame you. There's a lot of creepy people.
Yeah.
Just remember, if you're at an open mic and you want, just if Josh or somebody's there, ask him to walk you to the car.
Yeah.
Don't ask Owen because that might go sideways.
He's gonna ask for a ride.
Yeah, he's probably gonna kick Oh, this works out great, Angie. Can you take me back to my cave?
Some folks have asked me for a ride home, and I was like, I think that's a boundary. I was like, I'm not gonna let you in my car.
Yeah. I mean, you're young and you're impressionable, and I don't know that That's a good idea. But you have a circle of friends out here. If you ever do a show outside of the Inland Empire or wherever you go, mm-hmm. it would be nice to, you know, just text somebody and say, hey, I'm here. Mm-hmm. You know, it's kind of sad you got to do that, man. When I was a kid, I never even thought of that. I used to roam the streets at age 7, man. Never thought somebody was going to pick me up. But now it's crazy.
But even 10 years ago when I was in my 20s, I used to go out and not think of, anybody harassing me like that or picking me up and taking me. But it's evolved, definitely.
The early 2000s were pretty bad. I know you got to go, Jenny, right?
No, that's all right.
Yeah, no.
I also have a show after this.
Yeah, so we got to.
Oh, where's your show?
I'm dropping into Ava Dawson's in Lake Forest.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. To do my song.
Oh, I'm sorry. wait a minute.
Where's Lake Forest?
Let me take over the podcast, Gil, with your permission.
Yeah, go for it. Wife. Yeah.
You won't drive to Gil's open mic, but you're going to fucking Lake Forest? Do you know where that is?
Yeah.
Are you taking the fast pass?
Mm-hmm.
That's why.
Yeah.
You just go over the mountain. Mm-hmm. But that's fucking far.
Lake Forest?
Oh, yeah. Dude. That's past Irvine, dude.
This guy doesn't have a toll pass.
I don't give a shit if you got a toll pass or not. That's a long
fucking
drive.
Oh, yeah, you're going down to Mission Viejo.
Past
we're not
Mission
that far,
Viejo.
Angie. We're 35 minutes from here.
Yeah. Oh, but you're good. Are you on her book show?
Yeah.
Oh, what time do you start?
8.
Oh, shoot. Oh,
okay, yeah, we got to get going. Because Johnny, you have a show. You have a show.
Yay.
I like her. What's her name?
Ava Dawson?
She's hilarious, dude.
She's so funny.
She's hilarious.
The one that wears the really cool glasses.
Yeah.
I'll be honest with you. I thought something was wrong with her. I was sitting
She has an interesting stage presence.
Yeah.
I got scared a little bit. But then she was very nice.
Yeah. Interesting. That's a kind way of saying what her stage presence is. I was just like, what the fuck is going on? Like, is she okay? Where... I have a bunch of emergency numbers on my watch that I can call if somebody like her is on stage and go, there's a woman down there. It's probably not going to make it. And they'll go, okay, John, I've got the bat signal up.
Johnny Gold,
Angie. You don't like the bat signal? You don't like the little bat signal when he has the bat signal? All right.
We gotta go.
We get a lot of listeners. That's what, I want this podcast to blow up.
It will. It is. It's going
very
to.
Entertaining. We it's talk shit.
I know.
I think and, you talk shit.
Well, wait a minute. You guys are on the podcast.
Everyone but Angie talks shit.
I didn't say anything.
What do you mean? She talks shit. She's going all the way to Lake fucking Forest.
Oh, okay.
To perform with a.
Oh no, she did say to kill yourself. If
oh,
you
just
talked,
a couple of times. Only
if you
time.
Talked into the
all right.
camera.
Well, Amber, listen. If anybody is,
I'm gonna clip that.
Well, if anybody is gonna kill themselves, you probably did it on the last episode of this.
You got one more in there.
Crazy. That was awesome, Johnny Gold. Yay, Angie, thanks for being here. Appreciate it. Let's get out of here. Tell us where we can find you and what you have coming up.
Okay.
Johnny.
Oh, you can find me. There you go. Go ahead.
You can find me on my Instagram. I'm going to start posting reels, which is the move for the rest of the summer.
Yeah.
Because I should be getting a job. That's not it. That's my personal.
Oh.
Don't leave.
Sorry.
I won't let anyone
There's
call.
Mine.
There's Johnny.
Johnny Gold 777.
Wow.
If any gay
Sorry,
guy,
Andy.
If
You're
any
okay.
gay guys go with good abs, look me
Oh
up.
My God.
But Amber, go to my personal. It's in the bio. There. Follow my art account.
Oh, that's great.
You don't
that's
even right. follow my art account.
I didn't even know you. I don't even know how to work it. How do you click on something? You know?
But that's where all my stuff goes.
Oh, wow. That's great.
Yeah. Thank you. You didn't know I did this?
You Nick.
You should check out her YouTube channel. It is freaking amazing, dude.
Do you know how to do that?
I'll send you the link. I'll send you the link and you
Somebody
can just click on
me
the link.
I can do it.
Just
Leo,
click on the link.
Leo will help me out.
Okay. Leo. Help this man out, please, ladies and gentlemen.
But thank you so much for having
Thanks
us, too.
Thanks for having
Yeah,
us.
This was fun.
Happy to get in the same frame since you
were Thank you, thank you.
Lean in.
There you go.
I'm too shy. All the links to Johnny and Angie's stuff will be down in the show description. Check out the link to our comedy showcase in the city of Paramount. Johnny Gold's going to be there. Mikey McKernan, Lala Callum's. Sabrina Contreras, James Jablonski, and Danny Alvarez. It's going to be awesome. Tickets are only $5. Check out the link. Peace out.
Yay.
Let's see what else. That's it.
Yeah,
I thought I ended there. Oh, my God.
Looks like you got a lot.
It is the longest. Let's see. Shout out to Thicky Ricardo and Tangent Town, whatever that is. Oh, that's James Jablonski. Thanks for tuning in, listening to us, and catch you guys on the next one.
Bye.
Yay!
The Mind Buzz.
Of us there.
Thanks for listening to the Mind Buzz podcast. Subscribe to the Mind Buzz YouTube channel and watch full podcast episodes. Keep up with the hosts, guests, and upcoming events by following the Mind Buzz on Instagram @TheMindBuzz. See you on the next one.